Two careless car plunges overboard at Maikoni. Thousands of teachers nationwide took to the streets demanding better salaries and benefits. DPP appeals dismissed fraud charges against former Minister Jennifer Westford and her assistant. And in sport, England's Alistair Cook retires from international cricket. These are the major stories we are talking this evening. I'm Sandy Ramotar with this, our Monday, September 3 edition of MTV's News Update. Welcome and thank you for joining us. We begin tonight's broadcast by telling you that two persons are reportedly dead after a Burmese Bong taxi plunged into a canal on the Zealand public road Maikoni, East Coast, Demerara today. One of the dead persons has been identified as Michael Aubrey Rose of Queenstown Carmarthen Quarantine, who was said to be the driver of the ill-fated vehicle, and Jennifer Park, 17. The other occupants of the vehicle has been identified as Kevin Madray, age and address unknown, and Jennifer's sister Judy Park, 23, a nurse of Lot 25 Manchester Village Quarantine Burmese. Reports are that the car PMM 1423, driven by Ross, attempted to overtake a low-bed lorry which was transporting a heavy-duty machinery, but was forced to pull north since another vehicle was quickly approaching from the opposite direction, and in the process the car collided with the right side of the lorry, flipped several times, before plunging into a nearby canal. Several residents rushed to their aid and removed the occupants from the vehicle. They were rushed to the Maikoni Kachi Hospital, where the driver and a teenager was pronounced dead. Judy Park was treated and kept for observation. An eyewitness recalled seeing four passengers, including two women who were siblings, another man along with the driver being hauled from the car after it ran into a canal nearby. The car had on its spare wheel, usually referred to as a dummy. Police are investigating the incident. You're watching MTV's News Update. Join us on the other side of the break for the details of today's teacher strike action across the country. Stay with us.
At Optique Vision Care, we value the power of your sight. And with our team of eye care professionals, you'll be in good hands. Come experience our comprehensive eye examination using state-of-the-art technology and specialized diagnostic equipment at four convenient locations: in Mahaika, Grove, Giftland Mall, and East Street. At Optique, we care, you see. Call us today, 227-7744.
The secret is out. Tyo's Future Shop is the absolute best place to shop if you're looking for quality products at the lowest prices in the widest possible variety. Choose from a vast array of custom-made quality wooden furniture in endless designs, electrical and household appliances, clothing, cell phones and accessories, and much, much more.
Oh my God, so much in this store.
Tayo's Future Shop and Household Appliances, located at Anna Katerina, West Coast, Demerara. Free delivery available.
Credit, now me know the secret.
I like, oh, you know the secret? Everybody know the secret.
You can be a millionaire by only spending $100 on a Daily Million ticket. Simply pick any five numbers from 1 to 26, or you can buy a quick pick for your chance to win the Daily Millions. Purchase your tickets daily, Monday through Saturday, to get a chance to win $1 million every day. So, feeling lucky? Then buy a Daily Millions ticket today. Remember, a ticket today could make you rich today.
Sino Mall's lingerie collection is creating a stir for two sexy reasons. One, they're affordable, and two, they're seductive. Select from swimsuits, erotic underwear made to make you look good and feel comfortable while making your relationship spicy. we're ready to serve your favorite style that is sure to make him happy. And that's no secret, just take a good look. And we're not done yet. For the perfect shape, we have roll-ons and booty pops, along with trendy gym wear, at a fraction of the cost you would pay online, minus the hassle. So pick up a bra that makes you feel comfy, right here at Sino Mall, 16 Crow Street, Georgetown, right opposite the 40 Bus Park. Call 231-8200 or 617-6088.
Mark?
I'm in the kitchen.
This is amazing! I love your tiles.
Make an impression with the finest tiles imported by Lens. Lens has a huge selection of various tiles for your wall, floor, and pool needs. All of our tiles are of grade A quality, which are the highest quality tile rated. That means they last longer and are less likely to damage or crack. We're the sole distributor for many reputable companies around the world. At Lens, we have special deals for contractors and bulk shoppers. Shop at any of our three locations to get the best in tiles. Lens, our product, your creation.
Let's tell you now that there was absolutely chaos at many schools across the country as thousands of teachers made good on their promise and took their strike action, demanding higher pay. When this newscast visited schools in Georgetown, students were seen in a compound, but most classrooms were padlocked. Kipani Jordan reports.
I'm taking back my kids home because nobody is saying nothing on the door. They just got the door locked. I'm vexed with them, what they're doing right now.
What the government is doing, it's affecting a lot of students and a lot of parents. My brother's a teacher, and I'm feeling it for him every single day to know that they haven't been gotten increased since 2015.
If you want, you could turn Christian. If you want, you could take them home. So I'm taking my own.
Several parents of city schools. Many parents are throwing their support behind teachers calling on government to increase their pay. When this newscast arrived at schools in Georgetown, it was chaos as many schools are closed. While some teachers showed up at some of the institutions, their classrooms were padlocked as they refused to work. Most teachers were at the schools this morning, but left around 9 hours to join peaceful protests outside the Ministry of Education and Office of the President. At St. Margaret's Primary on Camp Street, the media was refused entry, but one parent said the classrooms are opened, but teachers are not teaching. Meanwhile, hundreds of teachers in Georgetown took to the streets demanding better salaries and benefits. General Secretary of the Guyana Teachers Union, Coretta MacDonald, said despite boasting about a contingency plan, the ministry was unable to get teachers to man the schools. Some 10,000 teachers across Guyana have downed tools after the government refused to pay them their increases from since 2016. An education task force established by the government and included government ministers recommended that apart from a 40% pay hike for 2016, teachers' clothing allowance be increased as well as house and duty-free benefits. When asked about the handing in of keys by head teachers, MacDonald said some have handed in their keys, but the ministry has started refusing to collect them. As a result, the union have advised teachers to hand the keys into the nearest police station. Previously, an injunction was filed against the ministry for cutting teachers' salary during the industrial action. The union had proposed moving to arbitration in exchange for calling off the strike, but that was rejected by the ministry. Kipani Jordan reporting for MTV's News Update.
The chambers of the Director of Public Prosecutions today said that his appeal, the dismissal of the $600 million theft charges against former Public Service Minister Jennifer Westford and her aide Margaret Cummings. The DPP said that a notice of appeal was filed in the Court of Appeal on August 30. Principal Magistrate Judy Latman on August 24 dismissed the charges against the former PPPC government minister and Cummings for the alleged theft of over $600 million from the former government. Delivering her highly anticipated ruling in Georgetown, Magistrate Latman told the two accused that the charges were barred in law as Westford was not a public officer at the time. She further stated that while Cummings was a public officer, there was no evidence to show that the money was taken and not used for its intended purposes. We tell you now that General Secretary of the Ghana Teachers Union, Coretta MacDonald, has issued a passionate call for President David Granger to intervene and resolve the ongoing impasse between the teachers and his government. Here again is Kipani Jordan.
Mr. President, could you use your authority as president and make the judgment call? Allow your ministers to understand that the people who we are attempting to neglect today will be the future leaders of tomorrow. Mr. President, I know that your heart is with the teachers. Please allow your words to be where your heart is.
General Secretary of the Guyana Teachers Union, Coretta MacDonald, in a passionate plea to President David Granger to intervene and end the ongoing nationwide strike action by teachers. Thousands of teachers countrywide have downed tools demanding higher salaries and other benefits as well as smaller class sizes. MacDonald stated no one in the government has since reached out to the teachers who refused to report for work until their concerns are addressed. Further, MacDonald reiterated the teachers are willing to return to their classrooms and welcome their children, but only on the grounds of a reasonable increase so that teachers can live a life that is comfortable. Countrywide, the number of teachers participating in the strike action stands at 3,800, with 1,000 teachers from Linden alone. When asked for a response on the Labour Minister's comment on teachers being, and I quote, uncaring and selfish,
thank you for doing two things. Thank you for reminding us that you were taught by teachers so that you could make the pronouncements that you're now making. So it means that you would have learned to one read, you learnt how to rationalize things, you learnt how to make conclusions, but it wasn't the conclusions that you were taught to make. Of course, students make mistakes, and so you made your mistake. I hope that you would learn from that mistake.
Thursday last, the GTU was invited to a meeting where the Department of Labor attended but took the government side. The Education Ministry decided they will go to consolidation. Further, MacDonald explained the union can no longer trust the Labour Department as they have compromised their position as being mediator between the GTU and the Education Ministry. Kipani Jordan reporting for MTV's News Update.
Even after publicly declaring his intent to not abide by a High Court ruling instructing him to activate the Judicial Review Act, Attorney General Marcel Williams is now denying that he ever refused to bring the law into effect. Here is more. Acting Chief Justice Roxon George Wilshire had ruled that the Attorney General must enforce the Judicial Act by July 31, 2018. This came after Williams was accused of failure to implement the law and his predecessor Anil Nandlal filed proceedings before the CJ to compel him to bring the law into force.
But at no time we have refused to implement the order of the Chief Justice. It was just the fact that since we had no knowledge of an interim stay, we were left with determining how to go forward.
However, Williams' previous utterances contradict his current position. On July 23, the government-controlled Ghana Chronicle reported that the AG filed a notice of appeal against the decision of the Chief Justice, which ordered him to bring into force the Judicial Review Act last month. In a notice of appeal, Williams called on the Court of Appeal to set aside the entire decision on the ground that the CJ committed a specific illegality when, by her ruling, she purported to dictate to the Minister of Legal Affairs her own timelines to bring the Judicial Review Act into force in contravention of the doctrine of the separation of powers. According to Williams, the Chief Justice observed the discretion vested in him by the legislature to bring legislation into force. Meanwhile, with regards to Nandlal's contempt proceedings against the AG over his refusal to abide by the Chief Justice's ruling, Williams said the former Attorney General was being spiteful.
In fact, the contempt proceedings he filed after the 20th of August really is malicious, because we had published the order on the order was gazetted on the 16th. We haven't issued it on the 15th. So we have shown a clear intention to implement the order.
The Judicial Review Act forms a critical spoke in the wheel of good government. It makes it possible for someone affected by an action or decision taken by a public authority to obtain a remedy from the High Court. In simplified terms, it holds those who make decisions in the legislative and executive branches of government accountable, ensuring that they act within the law. A police constable remains under close arrest after he allegedly struck down and killed a young motorcyclist Saturday evening. Here's more.
Reports are about 23:40 hours on Mandela Avenue, the policeman who was under the influence of alcohol struck down 23-year-old Akimo Anthony, a motorcyclist. Reports are that the constable was driving a heavily tinted minibus belonging to the Guyana Police Force when he collided with the father of one in the vicinity of Back Circle East Rumveld. According to a police report, the minibus PVV4652 proceeding along the northern carriageway of Mandela Avenue while the motorcyclist was proceeding in the opposite direction. Anthony reportedly made a sudden turn north in the path of the minibus. After the collision, he fell on the road and received injuries to his body. Anthony, who was in an unconscious state, was rushed to the Georgetown Public Hospital, where he died while receiving medical attention. However, eyewitnesses said Anthony rode out of a cross street and onto Mandela Avenue when the speeding minibus collided with him. The man was flung into a nearby trench by the bus. He reportedly received serious head injuries. His head, according to persons who were on the scene, was smashed. The policeman is likely to be charged shortly for driving under influence and causing death by dangerous driving. Jonathan Barkat reporting for MTV's News Update.
Still to come after the break, new HIV campaign to be launched. Stay with us.
Let FiberTech help you to renovate, refresh, and redecorate of your kitchen with decorative colors, finishes, and accessories. Choose from an array of designs and beautiful granite colors that are blended to suit your choice. FiberTech Lifetime Kitchen is durable, termites-free, and water-resistant. Enjoy 1-year factory warranty along with our after-sale service. So come on in and let us help you choose wisely.
Time, on time, every time. Our service is backed by professional and courteous drivers in safety and comfort. You know the numbers. Call 231-8600, 231-8601, 231-4000, or 231-4001. Located at 25 Oranock Street. So the next time you need reliability, safety, service, and efficiency, call Confidential Cabs. Safety first.
Modern Optical Service has made it even better by introducing its budgeted spectacle line, starting as low as $10,000 for single vision lens and $12,000 for bifocal lens, available in tinted or clear, complete spectacles at affordable prices. So hurry down to our main office at 316 Middle Street or Lot 14 Diamond Public Road opposite Demerara Bank. Enjoy over 60 years of eye care experience at affordable prices. Modern Optical Service, your eye care professionals.
Introducing the new Softex toilet tissue, now available across Guyana. Softex is silky smooth because it's made from virgin pulp. Softex is soft and gentle to every touch. Even babies can use it. Manufactured and distributed by BPATS Paper Manufacturing, Eccles Industrial Site. The choice is clear. Choose Softex toilet tissue, super soft and super durable, guaranteed.
Thank you. both styles. Simply different.
Welcome back. You're watching MTV's News Update. Attorney General Marcel Williams is expected to meet tomorrow with officials of the Council of Legal Education to discuss the feasibility of establishment of the Joseph Haynes Law School. Here's more. During a news conference today, Attorney General Marcel Williams told reporters the business plan and feasibility study for the Joseph Haynes Law School was handed to the Council of Legal Education. The council is expected to review the two documents, after which a decision will be handed to the Ministry of Legal Affairs.
And so the JV partners have come in. They, along with the local committee, will meet with the representatives of the CLE subcommittee on this matter, so that we could flesh out it. So the final arbiter would, of course, be the heads of government, if necessary.
The Attorney General said the establishment of the law school will significantly reduce the cost for persons having to continue their studies away from home. 10 acres of land has already been demarcated on the University of Guyana Turkine campus for construction of the school.
Our law students are punishing in Trinidad. You have horror stories. Up to last week, several have come to me seeking scholarships to complete their programs in Trinidad at Chiwoonin Law School. I don't know if you know that tuition alone is $98,000. That's $3 million Guyanese dollars. Just tuition. You still have to pay for accommodation, meals,
for a year?
And
for a year?
Yes. So it's difficult for them.
In January 2017, the Attorney General signed a memorandum for understanding with the University of the Caribbean and the Law College of the Americas for the establishment of the law school. Guyana and Jamaica have agreed on a shareholders agreement to finance the school at a whopping $6 million. The Ministry of Public Health plans to organize more HIV and AIDS-related programs and campaigns in light of a rise in number of reported cases among young people.
Minister of Public Health Walter Lawrence earlier today announced that the ministry is set to conduct a proper investigation on the number of new HIV cases in Guyana. Back in July 2016, then Minister of Public Health Dr. George Norton had announced that there had been new HIV cases in the country and that it was mostly young people that accounted for the increase. Minister Lawrence, in light of that, noted that the National AIDS Program Secretariat, NAPS, in a recent survey conducted, is still to definitively confirm the exact number of cases of Guyanese infected with the virus. Minister Lawrence explained, while the figures show a wide number of young people in Guyana are higher on the list of infected persons, further investigation is needed to rule out other cases.
Right. Well, first let me say that that number was not confirmed, and so they are working on it. Very soon we'll be putting out the CMO's reports, which has not been published for several years. Let me just say this, it is the responsibility of the Ministry of Public Health, you're absolutely right, to ensure that we keep our population safe from any disease. And we have been doing so. We have been looking at the trend since last year. We reported it, that we have seen an increase in the younger age group.
When questioned about the possibility of engaging and educating Guyanese with programs and relevant AIDS awareness campaigns, Minister Lawrence explained while the ministry is actively looking to do so, one must remember the present financial strain on the ministry.
Going back to what pertained previously, well, you would not see that happening on that scale because previously it was foreign funded. There is a lot of foreign funded in Guyana, in the Caribbean. What you see is happening in Guyana is not only Guyana, it's throughout the Caribbean. The funds have dried up. And so many of the NGOs who were gatekeepers are no longer existing, or they're not working as in a wide area as they used to do before because they do not have the support.
Reporting for MTV News Update, LaShawna Gomes-Cornelius.
Prison's wardens are likely to be charged soon for drug smuggling after they were caught smuggling a quantity of marijuana into the Lusignan prison at the weekend. Details in this report.
The Lusignan prison has a motto which reads, "Together in Service," which came into action when two prison ranks colluded to smuggle a quantity of marijuana into the penitentiary. Reports are that on August 28, 2018, the rank was supposed to work from 1,800 hours to 6 hours, showed up a few hours late with a quantity of ganja. The prison warden, who was stationed at the gate, became aware of the presence of the contrabands and cautioned the rank who brought it in. After, the gatekeeper subsequently allowed his colleague to exit the compound to dispose of the drug. The two wardens, when confronted by investigators, confessed to the crime and immediately tendered their resignations. The ranks are facing possible charges after the marijuana amounted to 398 grams. On September 1, 2018, a prisoner was caught with 71 grams of marijuana embedded in his slipper. It was stated that the slippers he wore when he returned was not the one he left with, prompting an investigation which revealed the drug in the sole of the footwear. This prisoner is currently serving a one-year sentence for larceny. When contacted today, Acting Director of Prisons Gladwin Samuels declined to comment on the issue. Jonathan Barakat reporting for MTV's News Update.
While the Rastafarian community has welcomed President David Granger's announcement that his government will abolish custodial sentencing for small quantities of marijuana, it is now questioning what will be the lawful quantity. Let's take a look. The Rastafarian community is elated at the announcement made by President David Granger to have custodial sentencing for small quantities of marijuana removed from the law books. But it remains cognizant of the past promises which were swept under the carpet. Amendment to the Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substance Control Act is slated for the National Assembly in October.
So we're hoping that when the bill is assented to by the president, it is not just put on a shelf and put on ice or something, but we get movement and we get some real traction and things begin to happen in a positive manner in our community.
How small amounts will be quantified is still unclear. Once one is found in possession of more than 5 grams of marijuana, a person can be sentenced to 3 years in jail.
And that small amount, we say, 56 grams or 2 ounces, and the ability to grow at least 5 plants in your yard. And also provisions for reform and for treatment for those who need it.
The EC was first brought to the Parliament of Guyana by Government Member of Parliament and Alliance for Change Executive Michael Carrington. Carrington had tabled a motion in the National Assembly seeking to amend the Narcotics, Drug and Psychotropic Substance Control Bill to remove the sentence of 3 to 5 years in prison for possession of small quantity of the herb. Some 36 students from across Guyana are now to be trained as medics through the 2018-2022 Associate Degree in Medics program.
The Medics Program is a collaborative effort among the Ministry of Public Health, the Regional Health Sciences Education Department, and the University of Guyana. Dean of the University of Guyana, Dr. Emmanuel Cummings, declared that a program recognized under the clear guidance of the Ministry of Public Health is indirectly registered with the University of Guyana's Faculty of Health Sciences Department. This, Dr. Cummings stressed, will allow all trainees the opportunity to further advance in the medical field if they so choose later on in their careers.
The public health department is a very important department, the largest department in the faculty. We have all the departments, the School of Medicine, the School of Dentistry, School of Pharmacy, and the Department of Medical Technology that offers imaging. So it's a range of products. We have 11 undergraduate programs. So you're part and parcel of the Faculty of Health Sciences and University of Guyana. So we bring you greetings and welcome to the Faculty of Health Sciences, to the University of Guyana.
Minister of Public Health, Walter Lawrence, encouraged the students to study hard and set their expectations high as they embark on a journey which will set the platform for improved health care nationwide.
You have not been daunted by the unknown challenges of the next 4 years. If you were, you would not have been here this morning. In fact, I know that every one of you aspiring 37 trainees have already visualized yourself replete with the knowledge and skills of a medic, ready to provide services of the highest quality to the resident in those communities from which you have come in 2022.
According to the coordinator of the medics training program, Sarah Daniels, upon completion of the program, the students will receive an associate degree in medics, which is recognized by the Medical Council of Guyana. She encouraged each student to maintain a 60% pass mark at each exam, including their final exam. In addition to that, each will return to their own region serving in communities where there's a great need for adequate, efficient healthcare services. Daniels assured students to stand firm in their commitment to their studies while away from their families and culture.
Remember, you all are here in order to achieve one goal, despite wherever you came from. It is known that all of you are represented by the different cultures and diversities of our great country. So it is expected that you all should have great respect for each other.
In 1978, through the Ministry of Health, the first batch of medics were trained to serve across Guyana. As more communities continued to expand with more residents in need of proper health care, services and medicine, particularly in the hinterland regions, the Ministry of Public Health has made it its mandate to ensure sufficient and competent health care providers are trained to execute their duties. Reporting for MTV News Update, LaShona Gomes, Cornelius.
Chelsea Griffith now joins us with today's court roundup.
A 32-year-old mechanic was today remanded to prison by Chief Magistrate Anne McLennan after he was busted with almost 4 pounds of marijuana at the Sano Landing at Mazaroni River. Selvin Lawrence of North Rumvelt is charged for having 1,625.2 grams of cannabis sativa in his possession at the Sano Landing on September 2, 2018 for the purpose of trafficking. The father of one was represented by attorney Clive Ford, who told the court that his client had no knowledge of the illicit drugs. Ford, during his application for bail, indicated to the court that his client arrived at the Sano Landing with only 3 boxes and not the container in which the drug was found. He added that someone else had claimed the said container, but the police chose to charge his client instead. According to the evidence presented in court by the prosecutor, Inspector Gordon Mansfield, the defendant was seen acting suspiciously when he arrived at the Sano Landing. The ranks then took the accused, along with his belongings, which were pointed out, to the police station to be searched. Mansfield disclosed to the court that the cannabis was found in a 5-gallon bucket hidden in a transparent packet about grease. The prosecutor objected to bail being granted to Lawrence on the grounds that the accused had given an oral statement admitting ownership of the drugs. The chief magistrate ruled in the prosecution's favor and remanded Lawrence to prison. The matter has been transferred to the Bartica Magistrates Court for September 20. A 25-year-old minibus conductor was remanded to prison today by Magistrate Judy Latchman at the Georgetown Magistrates Court for breaking and entering with larceny. Rico Prasad of Tamari Housing Scheme East Bank Demerara, who is no stranger to the court, pleaded not guilty to the charge. It is alleged that Prasad, on August 24, 2018, at Regent Road border, he broke and entered the Agriculture Sector Development Unit at the Ministry of Agriculture and stole property of Christine Kisun worth $5,000. Prosecutor Quinn Harris opposed to Prasad being granted his pretrial liberty. According to Harris, on the day in question, Kisun left her handbag in his office at the Ministry of Agriculture and went into the kitchen area. When the victim returned, her bag was missing. The bag was later discovered in the male washroom area. Prosecutor Queen added that CCTV footage showed the defendant coming out from a minibus and entering the Ministry of Agriculture's compound. He pointed out that Prasad was seen opening the locked door and taking the victim's handbag, taking it with him into the male washroom. Lastly, when the accused was arrested, Harris noted that he told the officers, "I done do it, man," and confessed to stealing the money from the woman's bag. Magistrate Latchman, after listening to the prosecution case and taking into consideration that Prasad recently served a 12-month jail sentence for a similar charge, remanded him to prison. The matter has been adjourned until September 24. Chelsea Griffith reported for MTV's Court Roundup.
Coming up after the break, MTV's sports update and more. Stay with us.
You can be a millionaire by only spending $100 on a Daily Million ticket. Simply pick any five numbers from 1 to 26, or you can buy a quick bet for your chance to win the Daily Millions. Purchase your tickets daily, Monday through Saturday, to get a chance to win $1 million every day. So, feeling lucky? Then buy a Daily Millions ticket today. Remember, a ticket today could make you rich today.
You minding me business? I noticed you yesterday. You're there watching. Today you're there here again. Why you minding me business? I fed up of your nosy self.
Yeah, baby, I just love your windows.
Why you bad eyeing me window? Like you housing a window? What kind of window really in your house?
I got some old louvers windows that I need to change.
Louvers? Best at it. People still got louvers window. Girl, I let you in for a secret, right? Beeson got a special deal right now. You go down there, you buy 10 window, you get a free bathroom window. Oh, for the love of God, try with them louvers window and go down to Beeson and modernize.
Beeson Windows and Doors, serving Guyana with the highest quality windows for your home, office, or commercial building.
Looking for fresh meals, tasty pastries and bread? Then visit Pam and Steve Bakery at 127 4th Street in Stone Avenue, Campbellville. Come and enjoy our daily breakfast and lunch specials. Choose from our wide variety of delightful meals. For the Christmas holidays, place your order for our black sponge and fruit cakes. Be sure to drop by for our Sunday breakfast special, pepper pot and more. Opens every day except holidays. So next time you're in town, remember to visit Pam and Steve Bakery or call us on 226-5338.
Did you know almost one-third of deaths in Guyana are heart-related? Chronic inflammation is the root cause of atherosclerosis, the process that leads to cholesterol-clogged arteries. You can now lower high triglyceride levels with Omega XL and reduce the dangerous inflammation that causes these problems. So to ensure a healthy heart and reduce your risk of disease, get your Omega XL today. Live long, stay strong with Omega XL.
Everything is connected, our planet, our water sources, including the water we drink. Sometimes harmful bacteria end up in our streams and canals. Although treated, the risks are high. You can prevent this pollution and contamination by maintaining your septic tank and grease traps. Call the experts at Puran Brothers Disposal Incorporated on 264-1239 or 603-5050. Keeping it clean is what we do best.
Welcome to Industrial Supply of Guyana, Inc., Guyana's sole distributor of NP and Ultra Lubricants, SKF Bearings, Seal and Belts, International Trucks and Parts, and Napa Batteries. With a bond capacity of 30,000 square foot, we offer superior brands at affordable prices and the best after-sales service. ISG supplies sustainable integrated solutions to make your business a growing success. Visit us at our new main office at Lot 4Q, Peters Hall, ISG, the best opportunity to make the right choice.
Welcome to MTV's Sports Update. Shabir Bakhsh, executive member of the Burmese Cricket Board, has resigned from his post, bringing an eight-year-old relationship with the club to an end. Bakhsh said it is with deep regret, but his decision was made reflecting personal issues. He added that he's been tried his best to maintain fairness towards the functioning of the club and the board. However, for personal reasons, he cannot continue his positions. Bakhsh added that his resignation was submitted yesterday to the Burmese Cricket Board. Blazing knocks by Chris Gayle and Russin Van Dersen, complemented by a devastating cameo by Mohamed Ala, helped St. Kitts and Nevis Patriots possibly clinch to the fourth and final playoff spot in CPL 2018 with a dramatic 7-wicket win over Jamaica Tullowers via the DSL method at Warner Park. Patriots were cross-cruising at 65 for 1 in 6.3 overs, chasing 207 when rain sent players off for a 40-minute delay. Scores in the match: Jamaica Tolliver's 2-6 for 6, Rowan Powell 84 and Glenn Phillips 40, Ben Cutting picked up 2 for 29. In reply, St. Kitts and Nevis Patriots raised the revised score of 118 for 3 with Ravi Vanderson 45 and Gale 41. Let's take a look at how the action went down.
Came out, Phillips, and he can get going, can be very destructive and very consistent. And Johnson Charles as well, he does like to go big over the offside and says, yep, I'm going to try and keep carving it. But he couldn't, and Debsich almost got in the way of Joseph, the first one down. Fabian Allen pumped.
Then big Kenar Lewis, he started with a maximum. But Phillips continued in brutal force. And what a catch by Sheldon Cottrell. And they were on top at this stage, the Patriots.
Yeah, they sure were. Some powering and smoking it. It's just extraordinary clubbing. But, when they go, and Phillips as well. So good on the leg side, searching, hooking and pulling. And the LBW, yep, straight after the drinks break. Absolutely, Gregory Brathwaite, I agree with you.
Off Carlos Braffick. Powell continued in the onslaught. Oh, what a pull shot. Dispatched.
So good on the leg side, and some of the fielding started to get out of hand. Miller, yeah, trying to play that little late dab. And enough on it, or out. Oh, skims off. Yeah, just take one and be happy. He's oh, you're kidding me. You have to be. Yeah. Oh, he's bowling. Should have.
Conked.
Up and over. Enough of it. Oh, yeah. Here a maximum. Nice. It's a power shot. And, oh, not quite. Now it's another pitching wedge stroke. And just over the top, he's been caught in that area a couple of times. He looked quickly, didn't he? Oh, that's good as well. No one there. That's back-to-back boundaries. Perfect start. Chris Gayle.
Gorgeous. Absolutely gorgeous.
No one there. There he is, Universal Boss. Oh, and he's in the wickets again. That's the first cherry he bowls.
20.
Yeah, nicely struck. That's a good stroke, and it's moving across the outfield nicely. Give him the... That's why he is crunching them tonight. Cheers. He goes again, and that's why he's playing it. And that's what he wants to expose this time.
That is going to be all the way for a hero maximum.
And that has been hoisted. Yeah, big enough. Andre Russell will just watch this sail into the crowd. Oh, oh, who wants it? Yeah, here we go. Yeah, gone. Oh, he's knocked over. The Queenslander, Australia versus Australia. Thomas has been hoisted. That is out of here, baby. Yeah, duck for cover. No, not just yet. Hero maximum, probably the biggest we've seen for Jamaica. But with no third man, chase it. One bounce for 13. Yeah, it's out of here as well. That is terrific. There you go. Oh, it's beautiful. Gee, that is just hitting two. Oh, they can't, and that's it. The Patriots have finally won at home, and a shortened game has worked for them.
England's highest test run scorer, Alistair Cook, will retire from international cricket after this week's final test against India. The opener, 33, has scored 12,254 runs and made 32 centuries in 106 tests, all England records. There is nothing left in the tank, said Cook, who captained his country in a record 59 tests. The fifth test of the series, in which England have an unassailable 3-for-1 lead, starts on Friday at the Oval. Cook is sixth on the all-time list of test runs scorers and has made a record 11,627 runs as an opener. However, he has been struggled this year, averaging 18.62 in 16 innings and has not scored a 50 in the current series against India. Guyana's motor races turned in a good performance as the 2018 Seaboard Marine Caribbean Motorsports Championship kicked off at Bushy Park in Barbados this weekend gone.
The Seaboard Marine Caribbean Motor Racing Championship is big on over four rounds. Each is hosted in a different country. Barbados, who joined the CMRC in 2008, Guyana, Jamaica, and Trinidad and Tobago, which returned to the series in 2014 after an eight-year hiatus. In 2018, there were to be no overall champions. However, there will be a CMRC champion in each of the four car groups and the super stocks, with country championship titles up for grabs on both four and two wheels. Round 1 was held in Jamaica in May, Round 2 in Trinidad and Tobago in June, and Round 3 in Barbados on September 1 and September 2. Round 4 has been scheduled for November 10 and November 11 in Guyana at the South Dakota Circuit. The results for the 2018 Caribbean Motor Racing Championship are as follows. In Group 2, Guyana's Ramiz Mohammed came in fourth behind Trinidad's Mark Gill and Justin Sanganet and Barbados' Mark Thompson. In the 600cc Superstock race, Guyana's Matt Truelove took the pole position, while his compatriots Harry Truelove and Matthew Vera finished second and third. In Group 3, Guyana's Ramiz Mohammed finished ninth, while in the Group 4, Guyana's Mark Vera finished second behind Mark Maloney of Barbados, while Andrew King finished third. Mohammed finished 5th in Group 2, Race 2, while Matt Truelove took pole position in the 600cc, followed by his brother Harry. Matthew Vera came in 3rd. Matt Truelove now holds the Superstock record after beating last year's champion, Bryce Prince's time. The new record is 1 minute 1 second. In Group 4, Race 2, Andrew King beat Mark Maloney, while Vera bowed out after a punctured tire, and Steve King with damage to the left front suspension. Chelsea Griffith reported for MTV's Sports Update.
The losing streak of the Guyana's Green Machine continued in America's Rugby Challenge in Medellin, Colombia, losing to Mexico. Here are the details.
After losing miserably in their first two games of the America Rugby Challenge, Guyana's Green Machine has shown marked improvements, putting up a strong fight against Mexico's Las Serpientes. While not making it across the line, Guyana was able to hold its nerve, but eventually went down to Mexico 48-36. The win was officially an upset as Guyana entered the match ranked 11th in the America's rankings, one place higher than Mexico. Both teams were playing their third match of the America's Rugby Challenge. The competition began last Sunday with Mexico facing Paraguay and Guyana facing Colombia. Both Paraguay and Colombia had opening day victories. Guyana was handed a brutal 71-7 defeat in their first match against host country Colombia, and then once more against Paraguay, where they were trashed 86-7. Results on the final day of the America's Rugby Challenge confirmed Colombia as champions, Paraguay as runners-up, and Mexico as a third-place finisher. They achieved 3, 2, and 1 wins, respectively, in the competition. Guyana finished winless, though the Green Machine played their best rugby of the campaign in the second half against Mexico. Chelsea Griffith reported for MTV's Sports Update.
And finally in sports, all eyes in Guyana following the World Archery Americas General Assembly, which they were represented at for the very first time.
World Archery Guyana head coach Nicholas Hing recently returned from an archery training camp and coaching seminar funded by Pan Am Sports and coordinated by World Archery Americas in collaboration with the Colombian Olympic Committee in Medellin, Colombia in August. The camp and seminar, which followed on the heels of the World Archery Americas General Assembly and the conclusion of the Pan American and Parapan Championships, was conducted by top-level experts in various fields of the sport. The event was attended by a total of 32 archers and 39 coaches from 22 countries, among whom were Olympic silver medalist Ada Roman of Mexico, Central American and Pan American champion Alejandra Valencia of Mexico, and men's compound champion Roberto Hernandez of El Salvador. The intensive program has sessions that begin from 8 a.m. to 10 p.m., and practical sessions at the archery range were coordinated by USA coach Phil Graves. A high-performance archery program can be developed from the grassroots programs, junior development in schools and clubs leading to schools and national competitions, and working upwards to win world championships in preparation for the Olympics. There was special mention of Guyana as a developing nation on the archery stage in the Americas, as they hope to soon be competing regionally in the Caribbean's development with sister nations Trinidad and Tobago, Barbados, the British and U.S. Virgin Islands, the Bahamas, etc. All eyes are on Guyana with tremendous archery potential. The next important event in the Americas are the Youth Olympic Games in Buenos Aires, Argentina in October. The training camp and seminar was a boost for Archery Guyana's development program, for which Hing is grateful to have been selected to attend and is thankful to his part sponsors, New GPC Inc. and Guyana Times Inc. Chelsea Griffith reported for MTV's Sports Update.
And that's our sports pocket for this evening. Stay with us, more news after the break.
Welcome to Industrial Supply of Guyana Inc., Guyana's sole distributor of NP and Ultra Lubricants, SKF Bearings, Seal and Belts, International Trucks and Parts, and Napa Batteries. With a bond capacity of 30,000 square foot, we offer superior brands at affordable prices and the best after-sale service. ISG supplies sustainable integrated solutions to make your business a growing success. Visit us at our new main office at Lot 4Q, Peters Hall, ISG. The best opportunity to make the right choice.
In the region, Argentina has announced austerity measures in a bid to tackle the emergency created by the country's currency crisis. In a televised address, President Mauriciano Macri said Argentina could not keep spending more than it earned. Taxes on exports of some grains and other products will rise, and about half of the nation's government ministers will be abolished. The government has not said which ministers will be closed or merged. Argentina is the biggest exporter of soy meal and soy oil and is also a big producer of corn, wheat and sorghum beans. From 1 January, those primary exports will be taxed 4 pesos for each dollar in value. Processed products will be taxed 3 pesos for every dollar in value. And internationally, at least 8 people have been killed in an explosion at a munitions factory in South Africa, a spokesman for the Fire and Rescue Services has said. The incident happened in the Somerset West District near Cape Town during the afternoon. The cause of the blast is not yet known, but an eyewitness reported seeing a huge fireball from 3 miles away. Firefighters are continuing to search for others believed to be trapped. The Hermetal Dental Plant is joint owned by a German South Africa company and manufactures munitions and explosive products for the South African military and police, as well as international clients. And that has brought us to the end of regional and international news. Now let's take a look at the Guyana Stock Exchange closing prices for trading session 789. Let's turn our attention to the Demer Harbour Bridge and the Burbies River Bridge schedules. That's a wrap on today's broadcast. Before we go, here's a reminder of our top stories. Two killed as car plunges overboard at Mikoni. Thousands of teachers nationwide took to the streets demanding better salaries and benefits. DPP appeals dismissed fraud charges against former minister Jennifer Westford and her assistant. And in sport, England's Alistair Cook retires from international cricket. Catch our broadcast at 23 hours today and at 6 hours 30 tomorrow. On behalf of our news and technical teams, I'm Sandy Ramutar, thanking you for watching. Have a good night.